Welcome, geniuses. I'm Genie, your best buddy for A-levels. In this channel, we'll bring you to explore the secret formula behind success. This is Ming Shen. She's 18 years old. She does ballet. She does Chinese dance. She plays the piano. She likes badminton. She likes basketball. She's afraid of the dark. And dogs?
But they're so cute and cuddly.
Anywho, Ming Shen was gonna study math before deciding to study natural science instead, before switching to actuarial science, then economics, and finally, engineering. See, that's what we call beating around the bush. But hey, Ming Shen has received an offer to study engineering at the University of Cambridge, and she'll be sharing her experience and advice with us today.
Hi guys, I'm Ming Shen, so let's get started.
So Ming Shen, let's start off with your engineering personal statement. What do you think makes a good personal statement? And could you walk us through the undoubtedly tedious process of crafting yours?
I think there are two keys, and this actually applies to our personal statements as well. Show your interest and be authentic. So my personal suggestion is to note down these three things when you're gathering your writing materials, and they are first, your motives and reasons, second, things you have done to widen your relevant knowledge base, and third, your related practical experience. So for the first one, your motives and reasons, I would suggest to make a list of questions and think about your own answers to them. And this includes questions like, why engineering, what drives you, how was your interest ignited? How has it gradually built up? Are there any specific experiences that led you to choose this course? What do you hope to gain from this four-year education? What do you hope to achieve, and so on? So the base for these questions is actually just, I like engineering, but simply writing this is not going to sound any convincing. Remember, we want to show and not tell. Show them that you applied for the course because you are passionate about it, and tell them how you became passionate about it. The answers for these questions should be highly personal because it shows what matters to you, why they matter to you, and what makes you you. Including certain specific experiences that are particularly meaningful in your journey can make it sound more sincere, while telling them the vision that you have set yourself can show that you are serious about this decision and have thought thoroughly about it. Next, things you have done to widen your relevant knowledge base, which could be wider readings, educational videos, academic conferences, online courses, or research on past, present, or any specific engineering advancements. Remember, you want to show our interest, and these activities show that you are passionate about the subject and are highly self-motivated because you are willing to use your own time to explore beyond the syllabus into the field. Instead of simply listing everything you have done, I would suggest to pick only one or two that specifically interest you about which you can talk in depth. Try to link it back to yourself and include your own perspective. What do you think about it? What impact does it have on you? How has it changed your perspective? What particular decision has this experience prompted you to make? And also, what prompted you to do this in the first place? This makes your experience a lot more reliable and personal because it shows that you are interested in the particular topic, familiar with the technical knowledge involved, have your own thoughts on it, and aren't just listing it for the sake of listing. What I believe is that facts and details are good means to prove your experience and extent of research, but beware that your personal statement should be highly about you in the end. So place more emphasis on what you learn, what you think, and what you do, because it's this that distinguishes you from the rest of the applicants who have had similar experience. And this makes your personal statement a lot more personal. Third, your related practical experience, which could be any engineering-related courseworks, projects, job shadowing programs, internships, or any other forms. So first-hand experiences are always good materials to write about because first, it's more interactive, hence you often have a lot of interesting viewpoints to write about, especially through engaging in conversations with the experience. Second, it's more unique and fresh because it's more unlikely for two applicants who have gone through the exact same practical experience than to have, let's say, read the same book. Third, you are actively carrying out some physical work, so there are often more to write about. For example, what have you done? Are there any practical difficulties that you have met? What are they? How did you solve them? What are your thought process while coming up with the solution? Did it work? What have you learned from it? Did you notice something and wonder about it? How did you clear up your confusion? So on. There are just so many things to write about. And also, since engineering is a highly practical subject, showing your relevant practical experience demonstrates that you have the ability to get down to work. Do not feel that you have to complete the list by mentioning a book, an academic conference, an online course, a project, coursework, an internship, and so on. There's no fixed numbers, but my suggestion is to only pick a few about which you can talk in depth and present your own thoughts. A lot of websites state that outreach bases data value on non-academic interests, but you might still want to include them since that's not the case for other universities. There's no fixed formula for this, but my personal approach is to unify my extracurricular activities into a team which could be related to my course because my activities themselves are related to it. What I believe is more important than stating the activities itself though, is to describe the specific things done within the activities while highlighting the qualities and skills acquired through so. Normally, people write about transferable skills like time management, leadership, self-discipline, teamwork, and so on to show how their activities make them more suitable for the course. However, I believe if you have fully justified your interest and ability in the rest of your personal statement, writing about something you simply do for fun while not linking it to your academics wouldn't hurt your application. In some way, it could make you somewhat interesting as a person, so it's up to you to choose which kind of effect you want to achieve.
Now, I was wondering if you could tell us about the assessment test you had to take. The ENGGA? ENGGA? Okay, I have no idea how to pronounce that.
It's a pre-interview with an assessment taken by prospective Cambridge engineering applicants. The entire test lasts 2 hours and contains only MCQs. It is split into 2 1-hour sections. The first contains 40 questions, while the second contains 20 questions. Each question carries 1 mark and there is no negative marking. The content is mostly based on AS level physics and mathematics, but the questions are purposely set to be challenging such that it tests the applicant's ability to apply their knowledge in an unfamiliar context. There are 2 main factors in ENGGA. First is the time limit, and second is that all of this has to be done without a calculator.
Do you have any advice on how to prepare for ENGGA? That's hard to pronounce. You know what I'm talking about, right?
First, go through the latest ENGGA specification which is available on the Cambridge website. This is to make sure that you are familiar with all the tested topics. Note down the added content because the past papers wouldn't contain questions based on these topics. Also, I would suggest to note down all the formulas on a piece of paper for ease of memorization. Then it's time for ENGGA specimens and past papers. It's a good habit to time all your practices, time how much you can complete within the time limit. This will make you more assured when sticking by your own pace during the actual test. Also, time the duration you need to complete the entire paper. This serves more of a basis for you to note your progress from time to time. Do not be too worried if you find that you couldn't finish everything in time, because most people couldn't, and this includes some of the offer holders as well. Accuracy is more important and we want to make every attempt count. So 3 basics, read the questions carefully, note the units, and reduce miscalculations. The past papers available are limited, but I personally found them sufficient for practices. Go through them at least twice. The first serves to test your basics, while the second tests your understandings on the ones you've previously gotten wrong while improving your speed. If you have become so familiar with the ENGGA papers and are looking for something fresh, there are a lot of materials available. So after familiarizing yourself with the specification and getting confident answering ENGGA papers, the rest of your preparation should be customized based on your own situation. If your main difficulty is speed and you're looking for some similar MCQ test-like questions, there are the PAT and MAT papers, also known as the Physics Aptitude Test and Maths Aptitude Test. These are the MCQ tests for prospective Oxford applicants. if you're looking ahead of the syllabus and are searching for some more challenging questions to boost yourself, there are the STEP papers and Olympiad papers. If you're finding difficulties in certain topics and are looking for some specific topic-based questions, have a look at the Isaac Physics website. If you are looking for something different and you just want some random interesting questions, have a look at iwanttostudyengineering.com website and Professor Povey's Perplexing Problems book. Do not be intimidated by the list. Do not feel that you have to finish everything. I didn't, not even a fraction of them accept the ENGGA papers. These are just additional resources if you have extra time.
Moving on, let's talk about your interview. How did you go about preparing for it?
I did quite a lot of practices. There are 3 parts of questions which you definitely wouldn't want to miss out. But before that, no matter which type of questions you are practicing, practice to think out loud. By that, I mean to literally speak out on your thought process and steps as you're navigating through the questions. The interviewer can read your mind, but you have to show them that you're thinking and tell them what you are thinking. For me, aside from doing self-practices where I literally speak to air, I also partner up with a friend to practice explaining my thoughts on the spot to an actual person. This helps reduce my unease and train me to shape my explanations in such a way they can be clearly understood. Also, mock interviews do help. It is important not to panic, but to be able to stay calm and construct your thoughts under pressurized conditions. Anyway, back to the 3 parts of questions that I've mentioned. First part of questions is graph sketching questions. And here are a few tips. Get familiar with sketching graphs. This includes polynomial graphs, exponential graphs, trigonometric graphs, as well as graphs with any combinations of them. This will give you a basic idea of how the graph looks like, so that if you were to encounter one during your interview, you won't feel too nervous and would be able to solve them quickly. That being said, don't panic if you are asked to draw completely strange graphs. Make it a habit to note these 5 things first. The intercepts, the turning points, lines of symmetry if any, what happens when x tends to positive or negative infinity, are there any values of x where y is infinite. You can search up random questions online or simply come up with some on your own and use Desmos app or calculator to check your graph. If the graph looks very strange and you get stuck despite having done the above steps, try to split it into simpler parts, sketch the individual parts out, know their patterns, then only combine them into a single graph. Also, try to get familiar with Lee Hospital's rule. It helps to evaluate the limits of indeterminate form so that you won't get stuck plotting points if the value you get is 0 over 0. The next part of questions is all questions in iwanttostudyengineering.com. It is perfectly okay if you are unable to solve the questions at first sight. Most of the time I wasn't able to, but I made sure that I understood the explanations and only move on after becoming able to explain it myself. I personally go over the questions all over again, and I would certainly recommend so if you have extra time. The third pile of questions is possible questions. This includes questions relevant to the course we've applied for. For example, why engineering? Why engineering in Cambridge? Which specific area within engineering are you interested in? Are there any specific advancements in engineering that particularly interests you? And also questions relevant to the information you have provided in your personal statement. These are normally questions based on the specific experience or technical details that you have mentioned. Here are a few things to know which help prepare for possible questions. First, reflect on your decision on your chosen degree and what you hope to gain from this for your education. That helps answer the why questions. Second, research on your area of interest or any specific advancement that interests you, as well as all those mentioned in your personal statement, such that you can talk about them fluently and explain the technical details involved clearly, or even better, able to come up with your own unique point of view. Third, read around and follow up news around your subject. That keeps you up to date and widen your knowledge base, which will give you some interesting things to talk about during your actual interview. That being said, you don't want to sound over-rehearsed, you don't have to memorize the full-length answers, but having thought through the points makes it easier to recall when asked.
And finally, do you have anything you would like to say to the applicants before we bring the session to a close?
I personally personally find the process of application itself really meaningful, and I wish you guys could make the most out of it as well. In the end, luck is still one of the factors, so good luck!
Boy, that's a lot of information to unpack. You've given us plenty to think about. Thank you so much, Mingxian. We really appreciate it.
You're welcome, Genie. Hope to see you again, and all the best.
That's all for today's video. If you're interested in more genuine sharing by other geniuses, please subscribe to our channel and don't forget to turn on the notification bell. Ding dong. Genie, we'll see you in our next adventure. Bye-bye.